also a really long history in my life. I've been there about 6 years. I did the whole before I got to a job, so the longer, which actually was a tremendous amount of fun. So today I'm going to talk about a lot of the work that I've done at SRI Robotics. My talk's really too long with too many cool videos, so I'm going to try and go through it pretty quick, but don't be afraid to just raise your hand and ask a question at any time. I'm happy to make this more of a discussion. If we start getting to the end, I'll make sure that I show you all the videos I can before we wrap up. So cool. So a little bit about my history. I had a really circuitous career path, which I find really exciting. So when I was in high school, actually, it just so happened that my uncle has the world's largest collection of antique penny scales, which is what you see here. So before the invention of the bathroom scale, you would weigh yourself in public, and you'd pay a penny to do it. And these devices were actually really clever, and they had all kinds of ways of sort of getting you to part with your penny, lots of gambling mechanisms. If you guess your weight white, you're gray, you get your penny back, all kinds of really fun stuff. So that really kind of seeded my love of mechanical engineering, and most of my life now has just been figuring out how to get back to that. And in undergrad, I actually ended up thinking I wanted to be an architect, so I studied art history. I got my undergrad degree in art history, and studied Hagia Sophia, which was this church mosque that you see right here that's in Istanbul. And also Frank Lloyd Wright as well, which more people know about. I actually ended up interning with a couple architects, which I think is a great idea if you're an undergrad and you're kind of curious about whether or not you want to do something. Internships can be great, great way to sort of try things out. Turns out it wasn't for me. I was much more interested in screws and fasteners than carpet samples. But everybody's different there, you never know. And so I was like, maybe I really would love to do computer animation. I've always loved Pixar, so I really wanted to, my dream at the time was to go work for Pixar. That really was pretty much right around the time Toy Story came out, which was the first feature-length computer animated film. Kind of blew my mind. That's a shock from Toy Story right there. That led me to end up doing computer animation for a robotics company, which is what you see right here. So this robotics company did deep sea salvage work. They sent robots down 10,000 feet below the ocean to pick up gold coins from sunken treasure. Ended up doing a lot of design work with the chief designer there, and realized I was completely unqualified to do that design work. And so I decided to go back to grad school. And so grad school, I did a couple of things. This is Wake's robot, which, let's see if I can get that to play again. This is my wheel-legged robot, which is a lot like some of the things you guys might have made. I don't know, I saw someone last year make this almost exact same. So there it is without the body joint, meaning a crash pad. Here, if you add a body joint, you show increased mobility. And each one of these wheel legs has a spring inside of it. That was the clever bit that let the wheel legs line up in a way so that it didn't fall over. And I was really happy. I don't know if you can see. Have you guys seen Big Hero 6?
Yeah.
So this lab, you remember the lab scene when they first come to the lab or all these cool things? That was like my grad school experience, pretty much to a T. And that robot that this guy's standing on is a Wegg's robot. So my Wegg's robot was actually featured in Big Hero 6. These guys totally did their research, and they visited a bunch of bio-inspired robotics labs. It was pretty awesome. Then I spent the summers in grad school making films about England. This famous version of England. So I had a really amazing advisor who was totally cool with that. And then my final grad work for PhD was on this crazy worm-like robot. So that's a single degree of freedom robot, one motor with nice smooth waves of motor, some clever mechanisms. And then that takes you all the way up into where I am now at SRI. I've done a lot of exosuit work here, so here's me wearing a super suit, which I'll talk a little bit about. High-speed autonomous motorcycle projects, full-scale humanoids, and then really what I've spent the last few years on has been novel transmissions. Technologies for robotics. So I'll show you a little. So here's the exosuit. Really one of the neat features about this is, so you guys know what DARPA is? DARPA is a military funding agency. DARPA is not actually super secret, it's just super off into the future. So if DARPA is willing to fund something, it's probably 10 years away from getting to the market at best. And the problems are usually impossibly hard. And in this case, they gave us the impossibly hard problem of making an exoskeleton without the skeleton part, essentially. Because the previous exoskeletons, it turned out that the skeleton was constantly getting in the way. It was extremely heavy, it didn't line up with your joint motion, And so they said, no skeletons, only exomuscles. And then you have to figure out what to do. And so this is what we figured out, essentially. Here's the little exomuscle right here. And what it does, and it straps directly onto your skin. And the skin carries the load to your bones, actually. And so this is one of the, I'll pass this one around, this is an exomuscle. This is actually a very lightweight for an actuator. Most of the weight is in the cables. And you can look inside here, you see there's a, what looks like a giant string. And that string is actually the, that is the actuator. So there's a motor right here that spins the string. And by spinning the string, it gets shorter. Very simple mechanism. It's been around for a long time, but tends to have really terrible lifetime, so, and terrible efficiency. So we were able to solve the lifetime and efficiency problem. So I'll pass this around. Just don't drop it. So that one there, that can pull on your body with 1,500 pounds of force. So when you strap that onto your ankle, it fires you, you jump, basically, whether you like to or not. That's a little bit on the high end. I'd prefer it to be more in the 200 pound range. Around 200 pounds, you can actually reject the signal if you want, which makes it a lot safer. So I had to do all over again, I wouldn't go that high power again, necessarily, for an exosuit. Here is me walking around with an earlier version of the exosuit. You can hear the sound of the motors going. And so how did we figure out, the biggest problem though was not actually the actuator, it was how to attach the body. And so what we did is we all went and took aerial silks classes. And this is not me. I have a video of me trying to do this, but I'm not going to show it to you guys. And what she's doing is she's wrapping up her leg in such a way that she can do a single leg hang, essentially. She's kind of getting set up to do it right now. And one of the one of the things that they don't tell you is that, like, Cirque du Soleil performers, they have a really high pain tolerance. And so even though we were able to hang upside down by one leg, it was just really, really, really painful. But it was still inspiring to think about, and a lot of the wrap angles that they were using turned out to be useful. And so what we came up with here, this is me being hung upside down by one leg. There's the body harnessing solution right there. And this is really was zero pain. So my entire body weighed 175 pounds at the time, being transferred through that thing right there. And what it is actually, it's like a Chinese finger trap for your leg, essentially. So the harder you pull on it, the more it squeezes you. But the real secret is that it distributes the loads really evenly throughout the whole surface of the skin. If there's any hot spot, then that's going to be extremely painful. Okay, so the next project that I talked to show you guys a video of Motobot. So Motobot was a collaboration with Yamaha, and it is a fully autonomous racing motorcycle. It's designed, our goal is to beat the fastest human motorcycle racer in the world, which is widely regarded to be Valentino Rossi. So we did a time trial against Rossi. He did win, but we had to give him a good run for his money, I think. And so there's a lot of really interesting challenges here if you're going to do high-speed autonomy. You know, the way that human motorcyclists win races is they do these really sharp bank angles as they go into the turn, and they almost die at every turn, basically. That's kind of their strategy. Surprisingly, actually, falls are generally pretty safe as far as falls and accidents go, as long as you slide out. If the front edge of the tire catches and you get launched over the bike, then all kinds of problems. So it's a really great way to learn about motorcycle racing, and get that autonomy so that we could make these very fast lightning decisions. And we got up to a bank angle of 45 degrees. We got a top speed of 140 miles an hour. So we made a lot of great progress. There's tons of videos of, this is called Motobot. If you search for Motobot, you see all kinds of videos of it popping up and stuff like that. The next project, this is Proxy. So Proxy is a full-scale humanoid. Again, this is a DARPA thing. DARPA said, make us a humanoid that uses almost no energy to move around. You want to have a robot that can actually work for 8 hours instead of 8 minutes. So it turns out a lot of the robots you've seen, like Osimo or even Atlas, if you guys have seen Atlas, these full-scale humanoids, they tend to have battery life in, you know, the 10 to 15 minute range, even though their battery might weigh 50 pounds. So that's too much energy. And so how are we going to do that? So here we are walking. So this is our humanoid right here. So what you're seeing there is actually using 400 watts of electricity, which is about 2 orders of magnitude better than the Atlas robot, the full-scale humanoid that we were comparing with. You see it's got a bit of a funny saunter. Part of that is it doesn't have arms yet. And so you have to, but the really neat thing is that it's using what we call a dynamic walking gait. So this is how humans walk. They walk with a dynamic gait, as opposed to like the older robots that walk like a robot. So the dynamicism is really important. But there are actually a few other really important things. We did our own transmission work. So typically, if you're going to build a robot, you go and buy these. This is called a harmonic drive. It's a really neat mechanism. I'll pass it around. This gnarled handle is your input, and your output is this big cup right here. And you see as you twist the input, the cup is going to move very, very slowly. So this is a 100-to-1 ratio. Or is it 50? 50-to-1 ratio on this one. So harmonic drives are the standard for robotics pretty much right now. But it turns out harmonic drives have really low efficiency, and since we're really driving the efficiency target on this, we need to come up with our own. And that's what this is. This is a different kind of transmission called a cycloid transmission. Cycloids have been known for about 200 years, but this one has some nice features in terms of keeping the efficiency really high because we use a bunch of roller bearings inside the drive. Okay, so let me see. Okay. So that, this is a, I'll jump around briefly here. You know those penny scales I told you about? Here's one of my favorite. This is a talking penny scale. You can hear the audio. So you drop the nickel in, and it reads your weight aloud. How does that work? Well, when you step on it, the needle goes to a certain distance based on your weight, and then the whole record spins, and then it reads your weight aloud. So I thought that was a really ingenious thing. This was invented in 1902, and some people consider it the precursor to the modern-day hard drives, the disk hard drives. Not the solid-state ones that you guys are already using. But I thought that was just really one of my favorite mechanisms. I had to throw it in there. And, of course, there's a long history of transmission work. This is the cycloid one I was telling you about. It's got kind of a wobbly effect. This is called a planetary gear. It's a combination of spur gears. It's been around for literally 2,000 years, invented by the Greeks. And then spur gears, even older, that's what you think of when you do gears, which is spur gears. And all of these things are doing the same thing. They're basically trading, we call trading torque for speed. So motors want to spin really fast. We want the outputs to actually spin really slow. And we want, instead of having high speed, we want to have high torque. That's this whole principle of mechanical advantage. And all of these rotary transmissions are doing that. This last one here, this is the harmonic drive one. You can see a nice animation of how the harmonic drive one works. This is the most recent one by far, 1957, invented by Walter Musser. Probably the most important, certainly the most important rotary transmission to come around in the last 2,000 years. And then, of course, everything by Leonardo da Vinci has really been a constant source of prior art. So if you're going to try and patent something, they'll say, well, hasn't someone already come up with the idea? And if you're a mechanical engineer, the answer is yes, Leonardo da Vinci came up with it 500 years ago. A little depressing, but always kind of interesting. Here, this is a roller chain, the same kind of roller chain you might use on your bicycle. These are two helical gears with off axes. This is a mechanism I didn't actually understand until deep into grad school. Maybe I still don't. Here's a continuously variable transmission right here. All kinds of crazy, wild stuff. And you guys have seen his helicopters and all these different things as well. But there's really actually, I think, room for optimism if you're a mechanical engineer like myself, because there's lots of new stuff coming out. This is a configuration of gears inside of what we call a ring gear that was only discovered in 2015 as a result of a discussion on a YouTube forum. And which is pretty awesome, right? And now like mathematicians have gotten involved. They found a whole new family of configurations there that didn't think existed. This one here, 2013, planetary gears with triangle planets with teeth on top of teeth. No practical use whatsoever to my knowledge. But it's crazy that someone at home with a laser cutter was able to come up with this and test their hypothesis and build it, right? So all the tools you guys are using this summer are actually really changing the entire field of mechanical engineering, I think. Here's my last one. This one's the most crazy. This is three helical gears. And if you imagine the way helical gears work, if any gear works, if one's moving clockwise, the other one should move counterclockwise, right? These guys are following that rule. They're both moving opposite directions. Now look at these guys. See, they're moving in the same direction. So you got two moving in opposite directions and two in the same direction. And they're all almost identical. The only difference is that this guy here is a mirror image of that guy. And that actually flips the output rotation. I would have never guessed in 100 years that this kind of thing would exist. And here it is. So I think that's pretty cool. And you know, some of the tools you guys are using, laser cutting, CAD and simulation is actually really big, really important. Ultra-quick turnaround, you guys probably don't do too much of this yet, but like right now if I want to make a load-bearing robot with metal parts, it used to be when I was in grad school, I would personally design the part using a CAM tool, and then because I couldn't really trust my own self, I would sit by this CNC machine for 10 hours while it cut itself out. And then I would break it and it would suck because it's like a $300,000 machine. And so it doesn't work that way anymore. Now you design your part using SolidWorks or AutoCAD, and then you upload the part to the internet. It gives you an instant quote. It tells you the parts of the machine, the parts of the CAM machine. You press buy, and 24 hours later, it can be in your hand. That's including shipping time. It's pretty remarkable. So that really changes the way you used to do work. So what used to take about 6 to 12 weeks now can take about 2 days. And then, of course, again, the YouTube's actually really important here. It's been a great way to discuss mechanical things. And if you're really into the mechanical stuff you're seeing here, definitely check out YouTube. There's all kinds of great channels. You'll find them pretty quickly. Gear Down for What is really cool. Their job is to figure out how to make high-quality transmissions out of FDM 3D printed parts with some success. And but there's all kinds of other ones. This guy here, this is Oscar Van Vaden. Sorry, Dutch. Oscar does phenomenal stuff as well. This particular picture I'm showing you is a 1 billion to 1 transmission ratio, which is pretty phenomenal. Some more kinds of fun, exciting stuff that you guys should definitely take advantage of. So I want to skip ahead here. I want to show you one really cool thing. This is a new thing called Abacus Drive. So using those tools that I was just describing, and a really fun design process that I don't have the time to get, show you all the details about, we came up with this new kind of rotary transmission. Hopefully it's in my bag. All right, here we go. Okay. So the neat thing about Abacus Drive, here I got one I'll pass around, it's a rotary transmission for robotics, and it has a pure rolling motion. So normally you think about gear teeth. The gear teeth are actually physically sliding over each other. Right? And that sliding is where the energy gets lost. So we wanted to come up with a way to have a gearbox that had no sliding. It only had rolling friction. So that's what Abacus Drive here is. If you look closely at it, you'll see that the balls are moving in and out of grooves, and the grooves are changing width. So this is a really exciting project for us. Here's the fruit. And so, I mean, the short story of this one is that tried all kinds of things that didn't work, and when I finally came up with this idea, I thought, could that work? I have no idea. And so then I CADded it up, and my CAD model wouldn't tell me if it was going to work or not. And so I spent a lot of time trying to do analytical math, like a few hours doing the math to try and figure out if it could be pure rolling or not. And finally it hit me, I was like, I'm wasting my time. I should print it and draw a little indicator line on the surfaces and then watch what happens and see if it's pure rolling. And so I did that, and it was like, sure enough, it was pure rolling. And so that prototype, that's what you see right here, actually. This is the first prototype I made. You see there's the little marks. And I put little marks on the wheels so I could see how the wheels were moving relative to the braces. And that was it. Turns out it took me a year more to get the math right to describe it as pure rolling. Of course, part of that was because there wasn't as much drive to figure it out because I knew it was pure rolling. But I finally said, oh, you know, I have to do the math, I have to prove to myself. And so it was another year before I got the math right. And here's another one, you can see the inner raceway. So these balls are moving in this raceway with a nice curve. So that's actually going to hopefully be a product. We're working with the company right now to take that to market. So. Okay. The next thing I want to show you is how I'm going to do it on that. Oh, they're good. Okay. So this is the early prototype of Proxy. Proxy is a humanoid, and he's doing these squats right now. And squats are really energy intensive. He said, well, where is the energy going? And so this is our actual accounting of where the energy was going as a function of time. So this is time. line is basically power neutral, right? So sometimes the robot is absorbing energy, sometimes it's producing energy. And it turns out when we look at these different parts of the graph, what we see is that the white area here is what we call mechanical work. That means that we've caused the environment to move or change shape. And it's generally unavoidable. If you walk upstairs, you've increased your energy in your body by mgh, mass times gravitational times the height change, right? And you can't get around that. No tricks can really save you unless, like cable cars, one thing goes up, the other thing goes down, right? Things like that. So the mechanical work you can't get away from. But the blue is actually the mechanical losses, and then the red is the electrical losses, right? So typically the blue is as large as the red, but what we did is we got a really efficient transmission. So we made a lot of progress by making the blue small. But the red, look at that red there. So it turns out that even though the drive itself, the transmission is like 96% efficient, the robot efficiency right there, I can put it back together. Yeah, did it pop apart?
Yeah,
here, just pass it forward two pieces, that's fine. Yeah. There's a not so good way to put it back together. If you guys come up later, I'll show you. It's not broken. It's okay. So what do we do about this? This is the kind of thing that we utilize. Like, how do we get really high efficiency? When right now, like, the system efficiency is like 20%. So what do we do about that? And it turns out that one of the key problems is that if we wanted to design a motor that could operate really efficiently right here, it would weigh like 50 pounds, right? But the robot weighs 100 pounds. You can't put a 50-pound motor on a robot like that. So you have to put a 2-pound motor on there, and that's why you get this huge inefficiency. And so what we really need there is something that we would call like a variable transmission. So like in your car, you don't have a 1-speed, right? You have like a 5 or 6-speed, or you have a continuously variable transmission. And that's really what we would love to have for robotics. There's another way of looking at why a continuously variable transmission should be important. So, no one wants to get hit by a 200-pound linebacker, right? But it turns out if you got hit by a 200-pound linebacker robot, you'd be much, much, much worse off. And the reason is because hiding inside each robot joint is this motor that's spinning at like 5,000, 8,000 RPMs. And it wants to keep on going the same direction. Just to give you a sense of how much energy is stored in that, don't ever throw a brick inside a triad. tremendous amount of kinetic energy just sitting there, basically hiding. And so when you encounter a robot in the real world, it wants to keep on moving, essentially. And that makes robots really dangerous. And so basically the challenge is sometimes you want your robot to move at high speeds, but other times like at high torques. And sometimes you want it to be back drivable, which means that it moves out of the way when you push it. And sometimes you don't want it to be back drivable. And sometimes you want it to be really stiff, and sometimes you want it to be really compliant. And so that's what we think a continuously variable transmission can get us. And that's a big thing we've been working on for the last few years at SRI. And here's the kind of CVT that you might find in your car. It's a V-belt pulley. If you took a cross-section of the pulley, it would look like a V-belt and conical pulleys. So the pulleys are shaped like cones, and when you squeeze the pulley together, it changes the belt diameter. Does everybody see how that kind of works? Yeah. So this is in your Nissan right now, or if you have a Nissan CVT. Toyota and Honda also have had them for years, and Audi as well. So a lot of automotive transmissions do this. And this is how they get variable ratio between the input and the output. In the case of your car, it means that when you stopped at a stoplight, you might have a really really low ratio, and then once you hit the highway, you have a high ratio, so that you can go as fast as you want to without having the motor explode from spinning too fast, essentially. So we took this basic concept right here, and what we did is we nested one pulley inside the other. So we took, so what we figured out how to do, to make this work for robotics, take this pulley and put it inside that pulley, essentially. And that's the basic idea behind what we call Inception Drive. So here's Inception Drive. We also have a nice hand demo here. I'm not gonna pass this one around, but you guys are welcome to come up afterwards. The really neat thing about Inception Drive, as you can see, here's one pulley in red, and then the other pulley in green, and the green pulley is completely inside the red one. And what that does is it allows, the green one is lifting up the belt from the inside, basically, as you cycle around like that. So that's a new way to do a variable transmission, and it's small enough, like this, to actually be in a robot. So that's the real key that we're really excited about. And the other neat thing is that this particular one here, I don't know if you guys can see, but there's a, see that black line, that black vertical line right there? So you can see that black line is moving in this direction, right? So I can change the ratio here, I can slow it down, and I can do a full inversion. So the output can now go forwards and backwards when the motor is spinning in the same direction, essentially. And so that's actually really a really nice trick for robotics, because a lot of times what robots end up doing is they end up doing these back and forth motions. And you actually end up putting a tremendous amount of energy just into the back and forth on the motor side. So this helps you not do that anymore. This is our latest Inception Drive, which I'm really excited about because it's finally fully balanced. So here's the little indicator showing the input speed, and this big wheel is the output speed right here. And this actually just demonstrates you can move at really high input speeds, which is pretty cool. And then this is, if you watch closely, you'll see the reversing here. Yeah. So there's the input moving in this direction. And okay. So here's the input and there's the output. You see when you place with the joystick there, you can change the direction of the drive without changing the input motor. So that's a really nice feature to have. Really excited about that. So that's about it. So for this particular robotic actuator, we're really excited because you can now like basically align the motor speed with the most efficient speed. You know, and that's how you get rid of that big red bubble that we showed you in the graph right there. It can also act as a kinetic energy recovery system. So this is something I'm really excited about. So like let's say, and they actually do this today in Formula Racing. So in Formula Racing, they'll have what's called a flywheel inside the car, which is a big heavy wheel, and they spin it up at really high RPM. It stores kinetic energy that way. And when the car slows down, it actually causes the wheel to speed up. And you store that kinetic energy in the wheel. And then when you want to speed up again, instead of hitting the gas, what you do is you transfer the kinetic energy from the flywheel back to the car again. It's called kinetic energy recovery systems, or KERS. And it's been used in automobiles for a while now. But it's never used for robotics. And the exciting thing about this transmission is that we can actually absorb the kinetic energy while it's traveling this way, and then put it back in the other direction like that. So now when we do cyclic motions like that back and forth, we can still do the kinetic energy recovery. So I'm really excited about that. And also can really have big safety implications because you can change the way the robot arm is going to respond to you. If you're really low ratios, it likes to move out of the way. If you're really high ratios, it becomes really stiff. So the last thing I kind of wanted to talk about, I have 5 minutes, and I want to make sure I have time for questions. And so I think I'll stop there. Those are all the cool videos. I'll show you guys all the cool videos. So thanks a lot. I'm happy to talk about any of the crazy stuff we saw here. Yeah?
I may have missed this, but how did you guys reduce the mechanical energy loss for the robot that did the squats?
Yeah, so for the squatting robot, what you saw was the best that we could do. Right. So now it turned out over the whole cycle, we still were much better than any other robot that had ever done squats. You know, so we had moved the bar significantly, but in order to take it to the next level, we think we really need this variable transmission.
I think she was wondering how you minimized your mechanical energy loss so much as compared to your competitors.
Oh yeah, yeah. So it turns out, so these harmonic drives, everybody uses harmonic drives, and the reason is, people typically don't historically care as much about efficiency, but they really care about a property called backlash, which is if the motor is locked in position, how much can you shake the output? In a factory robotic setting, this is really important because the way they do factory robots, it's all what we call open loop, which means that there's no feedback. They tell the robot to go somewhere, and then they assume the robot is exactly at that location. If there's any backlash, it means the robot could be somewhere else, basically. And so people have been optimizing for low backlash, which is what harmonic drives give you. But harmonic drives have efficiencies of around 50-60%. And so what we want is we want reasonably low backlash, but we wanted much higher efficiency. And that's why we did a cycloid, but we did cycloid with ball bearings installed in it. And that's in them, because ball bearings have a rolling friction instead of a sliding friction. That's how we got the improvement. That was all before Abacus Drive. So Abacus Drive kind of took it to the next level, in a completely different configuration that had pure rolling as well. Yeah?
So what's the efficiency of the Abacus Drive?
Abacus Drive? So it's pretty easy for us to get in the mid-90s, 94, something like that. I'd like it to be 99. So that's kind of what we're working on right now. You know, what can we do to get to 99? And actually, I'm also really interested in what we call back driving efficiency. So instead of having a high speed input and a low speed output, have a low speed input and a high speed output. That's actually really much harder to have high efficiency in that space. And it's important for things like generators or stuff like that, where you want the motor to spin really fast to absorb energy that way.
Time for one more question. Anyone else? All right, thank you very much, Alex.
Feel free to come out. I've got Inception Drive here you can look at closely. I've also got a pretty janky model of the three weird gears, if you guys want to check those out. So, and then I know some of you guys didn't see the Harmonic Drive, so I think I assembled it correctly, so it's back to functioning.
Very cool. All right, guys, check out the gears or start